Can everyone hear and see me or see the screen?
Yes, your slide can be very well.
Perfect. Great. Well, thank you so much, Maria. And I'm very excited to be launching today when we'll begin to hear about lots of interesting research that is ongoing. My name is Sveta Milusheva. I'm an economist here at the Development Impact Evaluation Department at the World Bank. And talking about how we can combine mobile phone data with surveillance data in order to better understand spread of disease. So as we've seen through many news articles and in our own lives, mobility has been central to the spread of COVID-19, just as it has been the case for other infectious diseases such as Ebola and Zika, and even more broadly, the flu every year. And so as we think about how to target these diseases and how to target policies to mitigate them, it's very important to both be able to measure mobility and impact of mobility. Until recently, the only way that we were able to really do that is through, for example, census data or detailed surveys, which are extremely costly and difficult to implement on a large scale. More recently, technology has made it possible for us to actually measure mobility on a much larger scale through the use of mobile phones, smartphones with GPS, or mobile apps such as Facebook. But when we want to focus in on low resource countries where many of us work, it becomes more difficult. So again, surveys are hard to implement and expensive. And many of the new smartphone apps are actually do not give a large enough coverage for a country because smartphone penetration is still very low in many of the settings where we work. And so in those cases, using mobile phone data can allow to measure mobility on a much larger scale and across many of these low-income countries. So I wanted to today actually start with an example that is focused on COVID, but help to walk you through how we can think about the use of mobile phone data and spread of disease. And I actually did my PhD dissertation focusing on spread of malaria in Senegal. And so I wanted to use that how we can also apply this to COVID. So in the case of malaria in Senegal, we have parts of the country that are very high malaria, other parts that are very low malaria, where they're ready for the disease to actually be eliminated. But the problem is that as people travel from high malaria places to low malaria places, they bring the disease with them. And so either visitors coming in or someone that has traveled to a high malaria place and then is coming back home. This is very similar to what we've seen with COVID-19 as well. For example, someone goes on vacation to Italy, comes home, does not exhibit symptoms, but then actually is carrying the disease and is able to spread it to those in their home location as well. And so this is really critical in how we can mitigate the spread of an infectious disease. So in the case of malaria, I use mobile phone data, which allowed me to have high frequency temporal and spatial data on mobility. I combined this with incidence data. So this is where combining data really can give you a lot more ability to look at a problem, to tackle the policy impacts of a problem. And so I combined the mobile phone data with incidence data, which allowed me to build an epidemiological model of malaria transmission. And using a linear dynamic panel data model, I was able to actually both measure the impact of mobility, but then be able to do simulations to understand how we may be able to use different targeting strategies in order to tackle this issue. And so in this way, when we combine different sources of data, we're able to build these models that are not just academic models, but they really can apply to thinking about policies on the ground that can help us do better in targeting our resources. So in that particular case, I had malaria incidence data across all health districts in Senegal, which allowed me to know what is the likelihood of someone coming from somewhere being infected. I also had much more detailed data on 5 low malaria districts where at the health post level, I knew number of cases. And so I divided those districts into health post catchment areas that were my area of observation. I then use call detail record data provided by Sonatel and Orange to look at mobility. So I had data on over 9 million SIM cards for 2013, about 15 billion observations. And it's important to note that mobile phone penetration in Senegal was very high in 2013, over 90%, but also Sonatel had a very large percent of the market share. So 83% of those with a phone use a Sonatel SIM card. And this is really important as we start to use some of these big data sources, is to understand what coverage do we have in terms of the people that actually are in the data, and who are we missing as well, because it's important to think about that when we're applying this to policy. I have an observation for every call and text that's made or received with a timestamp and the GPS coordinates of that call. And so I can see if someone makes a call in one location and then they make a call in a different location and infer that movement has happened. And this data is anonymized, but still very sensitive. And so it's important to treat this data with the highest level of security. So here I'm showing for one district that I've divided into 8 health post catchment areas, the mobility patterns over the course of the year. And I think what's really interesting is that even within a very close geographic area, you see very different mobility patterns over time. And so that's where when you have mobile phone data, you can actually really focus in on mobility to specific areas and be much more targeted in policies related to movement and mobility. And then the empirical model that I estimated for this basically looks at incidents in the current month in the location and estimates that based on incidents in the previous month, as well as potential imported cases. So this is the mobility. And then I control for rainfall and other aspects that may also affect malaria incidents. And what this allows me to do is to predict malaria incidents over time. And so here I'm showing for one district how the real incidence in 2013 compares to that prediction. We see that the model is very well able to actually track incidents over time. And now that I have this model, what I can also do is then look at, well, what if we didn't have any travel? What would malaria incidents look like? And we see the blue dashed line is what incidents would have looked like if there was no travelers coming into this district. And we see that a large portion of the malaria cases are due to travel. So mobility, again, plays a very large role, even in diseases like malaria that we may not think of as being as infectious as something like COVID-19, where you're having human-to-human contact. So in all these cases, we really need to be thinking about mobility. And here, just showing the actual estimates, we see that for a traveler is infected and coming into a district, we see an additional case showing up in the health facility in that month. But then we also see an additional 0.6 of a case in the following month. And so those are the additional cases that are being generated that would not have happened except for this traveler coming in and spreading in this new location. So then how do we use this for policy? So in this particular case, I look at how we can think about targeting. So in these 5 malaria districts, low malaria districts, there were about 7 million travelers that came in 2013, and they generate about 607 cases, so about 40% of the caseload. And so we can think about how would we want to target policies in order to address this issue. And we have both fixed costs and variable costs with any policy that we would implement. And due to the variable cost, it doesn't make sense to try to target all 7 million travelers. And so we can think about two types of targeting strategies. One is to target particular locations where we test every traveler coming in. Another option is that we target particular travelers that are deemed high risk based on the locations where they're coming from. And so with the model, we can actually look to see which what we get with different types of targeting. And so here I'm showing the cost benefit analysis for several different strategies. So one strategy would be to identify particular locations where that are high risk because they have many travelers coming in, and that's the purple triangles. And we see that that's not necessarily a very cost-effective strategy because we have lots of travelers coming in that are actually not high risk. They're coming from other low malaria areas. And so a lot of resources are being spent if we focus on every traveler. In the case where we don't have mobile phone data, we could just use incidents from the previous year to try to target travelers based on places that were high malaria in the previous year. But not only is that difficult when we're looking at new diseases like COVID-19, where we don't have this kind of incidence data, but also it could be the case that, that can change over time, and we're not factoring in how many people are actually coming from these places. So then what we can do is take it a step further and use the mobile phone data to identify which are locations where we have travelers coming in from high-risk places and where there's many of them coming in, so we can make sure that we're targeting those type of travelers. And finally, we can actually combine strategies to think about locations that are high risk, where there are many high risk travelers coming in. And that's the green triangles that you see there is sort of the most cost effective strategy that we could do. And I don't go into the specific policies, but we can think about, for example, right now in Rhode Island, a policy being implemented is that as New Yorkers are coming into Rhode Island, they're going around and looking at license plates. And if there's a New York license plate, there's people that will go and knock on the door and say, you know, for the next 14 days, you have to quarantine and stay inside. And so that's one potential way that you can actually try to target people from a specific location, in this case, New York, and in an area where we know that there are many high-risk travelers coming in, like Rhode Island, where many New Yorkers happen to have a second home. And so in this way, we can be very targeted in our strategies. So then how does this relate to COVID-19? What we've been aiming to do is to, in a similar way, use mobile phone data to study mobility and identify high-risk areas. And showing the case of Zimbabwe, we've developed a dashboard that where we showcase these analytics, looking at, for example, border districts and where people may be going once they enter the country. So we can help policymakers and we can work with World Bank teams to identify what would be targeted strategies. So if we see a case in a particular area, for example, within the city of Karar, we can then think about where else might the disease spread based on our knowledge of mobility patterns over time. Additionally, we can also look at density as well. So we know that congregation also leads to increases in spread of the disease. And so we can use the data to analyze and find areas where there's increased density congregating at specific points in time, which can help us in thinking about targeting policies in a way that will make them more effective and really go to the areas where they're going to lead to largest impact for mitigating spread of the disease. Ariana mentioned we've been working to mobilize a task force focused on COVID-19 mobile analytics. This is both working within the bank, but then also trying to work more broadly across different partners such as Flowminder, Dial, University of Tokyo, and kind of daily trying to bring on more partners that we can work with. First, to access data in different countries and to work with telecom providers in different countries to build out these country cases, to produce the analytics that can then inform policy. And then most importantly, as the World Bank, we have the ability to work directly with our project teams and ministries of health to actually implement policies that take into account these analytics and are able to apply them in order to improve the effectiveness of those policies and ensure that we're using our resources in the best way possible. So I'll stop there and thank you much.
Thank you so much, Sveta. That's fantastic. I'm gonna now turn the mic over to Marilise Gorgens. we're going to do a Q&A first. Apologies for that. So I see that there's a few questions here in the Q&A box itself. The first that we have from Winnie Mutai, I'm just going to go ahead and ask these two and then we can activate for anyone else that wants to ask questions. So Wynn asks about what are the data gaps you're experiencing in Africa and trying to deal with COVID-19. So you can speak a little bit to the work you've been trying to do on aggregating some new data response. That'd be great. Let me just read you two more. You can answer them as a group. So the next, could this data be used to track individuals, for example, to identify super spreaders? And the third is to talk a little bit about how to address the utility of this data with privacy concerns.
Great. Thank you so much, Maria. So I'll start with the latter two questions, which I think in some ways go hand in hand. In the work that I've been doing before and that we're doing now with the task force, we're focusing on aggregated statistics. So we understand that while there is this possibility that you could use mobile phone data information to track specific individuals, and we know that that has been done in certain contexts, we do believe that it's a very fine line when it comes to privacy, and it's important to maintain privacy of individuals. And so from our point of view, we can already gain a lot of insights from the aggregate statistics and understanding mobility patterns, and that can already feed into important policy targeting choices. And so we think that it makes sense to focus on those aggregate statistics that allow us to maintain that privacy of individuals and to work in a way that balances privacy concerns with also our desire to improve our ability to manage the disease. And so it's a difficult topic, but I think it is a very important issue to address, and it's important for all of us that are working with these new types of data as we're exploring them to ensure that we're doing everything in our power to maintain privacy and security and to set an example for how this data can be used in a safe way. And then to the first question related to some of the issues that we're facing, I think there are quite a number. So a big one is capacity. So in many countries in Africa, telecom providers are relatively small and they may not have the capacity to actually do these types of analytics on their own. And this includes even necessarily having the infrastructure to be able to do that. And so we've been working to see how it's possible to either work with our digital development global practice to support them in improving those resources and in improving capacity, and also working with partners such as Flow Miner University of Tokyo that have developed kits that make it much easier for telecoms to apply code that's already been written to their data. And so finding ways that we can make use of all these resources that have been developed by our partners in order to maximize how much we're able to do, even in cases where it's very resource constrained.
Excellent. Thank you, Sveta. Now we have a question from Sarah Rasa, which is, can you explain how mobile directly correlates to malaria or to COVID? I'm trying to understand the mobile data is that we're looking at.
Definitely. So we see that as I mentioned, as people travel, there can be carriers of the disease that are not yet infected, that are not yet showing symptoms, but may still be able to infect others. And so that's the case both with malaria. And with malaria, it's a little bit more complicated because you first would have to infect a mosquito, and that mosquito can bite someone and pass on the disease. Or with COVID-19, where you can directly pass on the disease to someone else as you travel and go to a new city or go to a different location. And so what the mobile phone data allows us to do is to better understand what are these travel patterns. So where are people likely to go? What are the linkages between different districts, between different parts of a city? So that if we see that there's cases in one area, then we can already know, okay, from that area, people go in these five locations. We need to really reinforce our policies in those locations, because that's the, those are the most likely places that we'll see the disease spreading next. And so that's how we're using the mobile phone data to help us think about this mobility and how that could lead to spread of COVID or the next pandemic. I mean, this, again, part of why I showed the work with malaria is just to show how across diseases, we have a lot of similarities in terms of how this data can be used.
Great, thank you so much, Sveta. And with that, we're going to turn to our next presenter on the panel, which is Marilise Borgens, again, coming from the World Bank.
Thanks very much, Maria. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you well.
Excellent. So unlike my colleague Sveta that gave us an in-depth insight into one intervention, I'm going to give you more of a quick overview of the bank's emergency COVID response, and particularly the different things that we're doing to respond with data analytics and digital solutions to rapidly target and improve the way in which the bank is responding with regards to COVID-19. I'm struggling to get to the next slide. So firstly, to say that there are four components to the bank's COVID-19 emergency response. As you can see, the bank is actually approving tomorrow at the board. It's already approved an initial $14 billion, and there's a second phase of the program with up to $150 billion in funds to help countries in four specific areas. Boost health spending, of course, relating to COVID-19, both the emergency response to contain, mitigate, and suppress, as well as in the longer term, recognizing that these suppression, mitigation, and containment measures have broader social impact to strengthen social safety. And we know that with the general just changes in economic activity that we expect to see around the world after COVID, that the need for social safety nets will be there more than ever. Thirdly, is support to the private sector, SMMEs in particular, and then fourth, to counter financial market disruption. I think we've all seen examples of that. And so this financing and technical assistance facility that the bank has, that's already been negotiated in 26 countries and will expand to others as they requested, is really meant to help countries address the short and long-term impacts of COVID-19. And this is the result framework in the theory of change of what this financing is meant to achieve. You can see, and I'm not going to go into this into too much detail, you can see there are five typical components to these projects. The short-term component one activities is where I'm going to spend most of the time in this presentation, just to take you through what are some of the data analytics and digital solutions that these projects will employ. Firstly, just to say that how does analytics and digital solutions have already been used in COVID-19 responses? I think we would all agree that the use has been unprecedented to date. Famously, Blue Dot's AI system picked up an anomaly in reporting based on travel patterns, based on social media feeds, etc. On the 31st of December, WHO CDC reported the existence of such a report on the 6th of January, and WHO notified the world on January 9th. So that was just right at the very start. There's also several predictive models out there to both predict epidemic spread, health system capacity, as well as the impact of both pharmaceutical and non-pharmaceutical interventions. In fact, our global response around flattening the curve and reducing, stretching out the epidemic and reducing health system excess demand is flattening the curve. That is all about predictive models. We know that there are a plethora of digital interventions that are either currently being developed or already customized. Sveta referred to one of them. I'm the person in the World Bank who's coordinating data and analytics for COVID-19. And I am absolutely inundated with folks who email every day to say, we have developed a new app. And I think there is opportunity in that, but there's also risk in that. The US government created a COVID-19 open research data set. It has 24,000 articles in it with the Allen Institute for AI. Since then, there has been a data collaboratives for COVID that's been established. Let me tell you a little bit more about that. Just back to my point around the plethora of digital interventions, this chart is already outdated. It shows 268 coronavirus-related innovations that have already been recorded. And as I said, this was Thursday last week, and between Thursday morning and Thursday afternoon, 40 more were added to the list. So they just keep increasing. In terms of the COVID-related data, the bank has its development data partnership and the data collaboratives initiative. There's also the data collaboratives in response to COVID-19 effort. There's another COVID-Net, which is a neural network design where they're trying to use CT scans, chest x-rays, to rapidly detect coronavirus-related pneumonia from regular pneumonia. And so use it for diagnostic purposes. So there are four ways in which the bank is supporting countries to use big data and analytics to improve their COVID responses. The first one is, of course, analytics to predict the future spread and the impact of different response options to help countries make choices in that regard. You can see here that there are a variety of models available. There's seven online models that are listed here. On the next page, you can see there's also various modeling groups, and we haven't even listed all of them here, Harvard, MIT, Imperial, Johns Hopkins, that are all and have all produced some kind of model to look at the potential for epidemic spread, the potential for interventions, by how much the health system will be overloaded, etc. And so the idea is that these models and estimates are used by countries as they plan what their COVID-19 emergency responses are, as they plan whether they're still in a stage where they can think about containment or they have to think about mitigation or suppression, for example. And then if there are any mathematical modelers on the call today, you might be happy to know that we will be co-convening together with IDSI, the International Decision Support Initiative, an effort to try and align or harmonize or bring these different models together to see that we, every day I seem to find a new model that's being developed. And is there a way that we can learn from each other and have a collaborative instead of these disparate and different modeling efforts? And our intent is also to link it to the bank's economic impact, macroeconomic impact modeling, which is also happening. This shows you from Imperial College in different countries, depending on whether there's no interventions or unmitigated, unmitigated, including 70% social distancing compliance and mitigation, including enhanced social distancing of the elderly. So basically the elderly are locked down in their homes and the vulnerable groups, and they cannot leave for a period of time. So this just shows you what will happen to requiring hospital beds, deaths per 1,000 population, etc. This is just an example of one of these predictive models that are out there. The second kind of big data and analytics that we will be using and supporting countries with is to analyze and identify both geographic and subpopulation hotspots. Let me show you this example from Vermont in New York, where if we knew where index cases were and we knew we could use all the different data here, for example, weather data, mobile network operator data, airline traffic data to look at movement, disease burden data to get a sense of the vulnerability of the population, diabetes, heart disease, asthma, etc., population density, key service suppliers. If we could do all of that and get a weighted risk score calculation, then we can identify which geographic locations are more important and where we should start if a country can't start immediately everywhere. So looking at that, sorry, I'm going in the wrong direction. Looking at that, this is just showing you, can we use this kind of data around population density? Can we use this kind of data around age if we look at the high-risk zones, just age-related? But if we bring them all together, there was actually an analysis that was done, not in Vermont and New York, but in Malawi, in Africa, to bring together and to understand the red districts are the higher risk score districts. And so those are the districts where you want to urgently start with your containment, your testing, your tracing, and your quarantining processes. There are various things that we need for all this to work together, but it needs, as Sveta said in the previous slide, it obviously needs the mobile network operator data to be able to do that. But this is something that could rapidly be expanded. There are other approaches to using big data to sense COVID infection signals, and therefore to sense where is priority areas, which are priority populations where we need to start. This list here, and some of my colleagues working on these different interventions, if you're interested in any of them, let me know and we'd be happy to introduce you to these colleagues at the World Bank. The third area is to do with analytics and data to monitor, track, change, and evaluate implementation. Here you can see from Facebook mobility data, you can see how mobility patterns have changed in Milan, in Italy. We can also use this kind of Facebook mobility data and other data like data from Waze or data from Cubic to look at whether at other social distancing metrics in terms of what works, changes in the frequency of movement, the distance of movement, etc. And this is really important from the bank's project perspective, because looking at whether social distancing works or not is one of the standard indicators in our projects. Then the next one is looking at analytics to look at the wider impact of the COVID pandemic, but also the response mechanisms on economic activity and on livelihoods, on employment, on skills, etc. Beyond the different kinds of analytics, there's also a plethora of digital solutions that embed mainly machine learning analytics to understand and to improve how interventions works. Here you can see just different inventories and online conference that's already taken place, etc., with digital health solutions for COVID-19. One of the bank's concerns and one of the areas we're working on with several service providers is that instead of having 1,000 flowers bloom approaches, we need to link and we need to have an integrated set of digital health solutions that work in unison and that work together. Instead of letting 1,000 flowers bloom, we need a bouquet of digital health solutions, and those bouquets will look different in different countries, but it's fundamental that we get that right. Here are some examples of add-ons to existing mobile services. There are many other ways in which we could do this. This is an effort of the WHO where if you send a WhatsApp message to that number on your screen and you type hi, this app appears, this WhatsApp conversation appears. You can either use numbers or the emojis on the screen, and you can answer specific questions that are answered through the app. Through just creating this, anybody with a WhatsApp account, and there are 2 billion of them in the world, can be reached with an intervention like this. So there are some really low cost, really cheap things that we could do that could have a big impact. This is another example, and I'm going to end here because I think I'm out of time, is that tracking of potentially positive cases, confirmed positive cases, and mobility related tracking to identify high risk individuals or high risk areas that a newly diagnosed person has been has moved through, and others who might be at risk because of that is, as I said, an area that's absolutely exploded. I literally get an email a day from somebody who's developed a new approach to tracking. I do think we need to be very careful in all these tracking apps that we don't create a massive surveillance state, and that we have mechanisms to roll back these kinds of activities. This is an example of an app that's actually been endorsed by WHO. There will be a WHO app for COVID-19 with several apps that can be downloaded within a WHO app store. This is one of the endorsed ones that will be in there. And the reason why WHO endorsed it is because it does privacy tracking without government tracking. So both the health facility and the individual downloads apps on their phones. And if the health facility locates an intervention documents a new diagnosed case, everybody who has the Safe Paths app and who were in the vicinity of the person who was just diagnosed, who has the app on their phone as well, will be notified without the authorities being notified, right? So it's like tracking you will be notified if somebody that you were close to or with have been diagnosed with COVID-19, but the government won't know your movement. So it's one of those ways in which we can establish those kinds of boundaries in a way that's good and safe and healthy. Let me end with this last slide, which I think is also really important, and that is in tracking tools like this that will read on a continuous basis the temperature of health workers. We know how important it is to keep them safe. I'm sure many of you saw yesterday in the New York Times the article about the digital thermometers that are connected and wearable devices, where they've already seen the positive impact of social distancing in terms of, in specific hotspot areas, reducing the average temperature of people who are in those areas. So there is a lot of opportunity for data analytics and these digital solutions to change what and where and how COVID-19 is implemented, but we have to figure out ways in which they can work together. And I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much. Thanks, Maria.
Thanks, Marilise. That's super interesting. Everyone who has questions, please use either the Q&A box or the chat box, and I can share those with our speaker. So let me give you, Marilise, let me give you the first few questions that have come up here, and then we can do another round. So the first is how many of these data, the first question comes from Akshay Devarakonda. Apologies if a mispronunciation there. How many of these data elements are open source? And as a follow-up, is the best kind of data for these predictive analytics proprietary or open source? And then the second question is, how should we think about the balance between false negatives versus false positives in the predictive analytics tools? So quite different questions. Let me leave you with those two, and then we can do another round.
So first of all, in terms of the open source data, the bank believes very much in open source data. All of our data are openly available. And I would say that we, through the data collaboratives initiative that the bank has established, we actively work with private sector providers to ensure that data are available. That said, we also have to ensure that people give consent, and we have to ensure that there are safeguards through data stewards and data controllers in place, ensuring that these data are not used for nefarious purposes. So I think it's about finding that middle ground. I think we can also use proprietary data, and proprietary data are used these days with very powerful effect. The bank, when we do use proprietary data, sign data license agreements that governs how we will use that data and what we will do with the data after the analytics is important. So I think as long as those kinds of governance mechanisms are in place, they're both important and they can both work. The question about false positives and false negatives. So we would always argue that a decision about somebody's status and a decision about treatment options should be made by a clinician after a clinical investigation has been done. So we wouldn't argue for beginning people on mass treatment or, distributing hydroxychloroquine just based on predictive analytics. I think if a country has 10,000 health workers, like South Africa is sending out 10,000 community health workers to go and do door-to-door testing, where do you start? Because there are many more than 10,000 households in South Africa. So knowing where to start first is what I think the power of this predictive analytics is, not undermining or superseding the necessary clinical process that it needs to be accompanied with. Thanks, Maria.
All right, another question here for you is, what are the best AI models or predictive analytics you've seen since this outbreak? Perhaps you could name three. They could be apps, models, or tools.
I'm not going to answer that question because I think that, what I tried to say in my presentation is that we need to try and figure out how these different tools can work together. I think there are many startups and many established firms doing really interesting things. I think it's very context specific, right? Countries that have a national VMO system, for example, or countries that already uses Access Mobile, adding on a COVID module to that, as opposed to starting from scratch, is where you would go, right? So it isn't to me that there is a best one. I think the best ones are the ones where many of these solutions work in unison together. And I think that's by far the biggest challenge in the digital health world, is that there are just too many flowers. It is the wild west of everybody developing their own standalone app. And I think we stand the risk of creating confusion with governments. In fact, in these projects that we finance, if a government says, well, I want to develop an app, we will always say to them, well, here are the ones that are already there. Can we customize? Can we adapt? Can we link to what you have instead of starting from scratch?
Excellent. Thanks. Thanks, Marilise. So we have, let's do at least one more question. This question is about how can audience members contribute to the conversation about collaborative analysis, and what directions do you think that collaboration is heading? So maybe just a little bit of thoughts about people who are interested in directly getting involved, if there's opportunities to do that, or ways to follow along, what the status of the collaboration is.
Yeah, absolutely. So yes, there are opportunities. If it's relating to the modeling work that I mentioned, you feel free to reach out to me. I'm coordinating that effort in the bank. And then if it's more in the space of collaborating in terms of the data space, there's the COVID Data Collaboratives Initiative or the Bank's Data Collaborative Initiative, that again, reach out to either the conference organizers or me, and I'd be happy to put you in touch with the right folks. We're always looking for people who want to join the moving train, make the bouquet bigger.
Super. Thank you so much, Marilise. That was really, really interesting and informative. And now I'm going to introduce the last speaker for this panel, who is Emmanuel Letouze from the Data Pop Alliance. Emmanuel, I hand the mic over to you.
Okay, great. Thank you. Yeah, so my name is Emmanuel Letouze. I'm the director and co-founder of Data Pop Alliance. I'll just describe briefly what Data Pop Alliance is and does. I'm also one of the co-founders of the Open Algorithms or OPAL project, and I'm a fellow, a connection science fellow at MIT. And some of the work that was described, including Safe App Path app, came out of MIT. So Data Pop Alliance is it's a nonprofit that came out of a Harvard and MIT 7 years ago. We work in the Global South through what we call like diagnostic work, mobilization, and transformation work. So I'll come back to that just by way of a quick introduction. So I'm going to try and provide a bit of a like political but also like quite pragmatic, hopefully perspective on what I think and how I think, as the title said, that data can help address some of the challenges that the current crisis is posing, but also exposing, because this crisis is taking place, especially when we think about the Global South, in regions and countries that are already facing a lot of challenges. And in some of those cases or some of those places, the sort of like the solutions that are relevant for the US may not be realistic for some of those countries. So I think the first comment is that it's very important to understand through data the extent which you're working and how any given model or any given recommendation needs to be applied or adjusted. And so it's clear that in some cases some people are worried that they may die of hunger before they die of the virus, and this is something that is I think like extremely critical to understand. And so I just mentioned those very like structural challenges that some countries are facing that were already mentioned by some of the presenters. So lack of basic data, lack of basic like medical infrastructure, lack of social safety net, like political instability, very high levels of domestic violence in some countries. Which are already like prevalent, and they are both exposed. They can be enhanced by the crisis. Also, in the sort of like global north perspective, if you look at what's happening in the US or in Europe, we had all the information we needed for weeks, and yet we didn't act as we should have. So it's also I think a sobering remark that next time around, we should think about how to act on information. Another way in which I think the global north has also failed is that 6 years ago there was the Ebola crisis, and I was with many others on many community calls about whether how cell phone data could be shared, could be used to do modeling, prediction, spread, modelization, contact tracing, and so on and so forth. And it sort of didn't work. And you can see the title here in the top left corner. It was 2014. So it is indeed almost 6 years ago. There was a report written about this sort of this failure, so a big disaster. And since then, there have been lots of discussions about how those kinds of very sensitive private data could be shared, or rather than shared, accessed and analyzed for research and public good purposes. So you see some of the papers that have come out over the past few years trying to offer some technological and governance solutions to that governance, to this access and governance problem. And very recently, this is at the bottom right corner, very recently we published on March 27th an article with a few members of this so-called big data for a good community, basically saying that what we were seeing is indeed a missed opportunity, because there are all those initiatives happening where some groups try to get access and some succeed in accessing, analyzing cell phone data to do a number of things, very useful, but it's not it's not coherent. It's not always necessarily very safe. It's not systematic. So I think in the future, we really need as a community, but also as just a societies, come together and try to find those technical standards and governance standards to do this systematically and safely. So now, having said that, I just want to give some pointers on how I think very pragmatically, concretely, how I think on personal level, how I think that data can help address the challenges that the crisis is posing and exposing. So first, I think it's not just about research and insights. So I think you need a multi-pronged approach. So this is what I would call in our data jargon, diagnosing, but it can be called anything else. It's research, assessment, evaluation, but to get a very good understanding of the context, a good understanding also of how modeling can help, etc. There is also a component that which I think is critical, which we call mobilize. Likewise, it can be called anything else, but it's about building local connections or relying on local connections, capacities, networks, in both in complex ecosystems terms when you develop a project. And then third, so we call it transform. Here, the idea is to not just try to respond to the current crisis, to the current humanitarian sanitary crisis, which is of course the utmost emergency, but also to think long term and to think in transformative terms and try to reflect about why it happened that way. Why are there no safety nets in so many countries? So you also get very quickly to politics, and I think the world post-COVID will have to be very different from one before. And then we also have a list of some of the features. I really think that it needs to be, we shouldn't talk in terms of we. It really needs to be locally grounded, building on local networks. For example, it's clear that awareness, local information is critical. If people do not believe what the public authorities are saying about containment measures, about the the actual like veracity of the virus, et cetera, like nothing is gonna work. So you can have the best models. If people do not believe that they are at risk, they will move around. And also in some cases, they won't have a choice. So they will have to keep working. So you also have to take that into account. So, and this is just some pointers of things in each of those three categories that I think data can help with, and ways in which it can be used. So first, I think there's a whole like diagnostic kind of pot of activities and like actions that can be implemented. So I will just the details of the slide can be shared, but I would just go just through the sort of like the highlights. I think very quickly we need, and we've started as data hub in a few countries, but we can't cover them all. I think there needs to be a sort of like systematic assessment of country risks and readiness to be done, but also like qualitatively, like we need to ask people what their main concerns are about in terms of livelihoods, in terms of domestic violence. So beyond just the public health impact of the crisis. So it's not just a dashboard of the number of cases, the number of deaths, etc. It's also a more like qualitative assessment of the local context. Then secondly, as Sveta mentioned and other mentioned, there is of course a very large body of work that can be done through cell phone data, not only cell phone data, but so to try and model which the effect of confinement measures. So there is the work that Sandy Pentland and Esteban Moro and others just published on the effect of confinement measures in New York. And I think this can be replicated in many countries. Third, I think we have to look at the corollary effects of the crisis. So here I'm talking about domestic violence, which I've already mentioned. I'm talking about educational like gaps. I'm talking about just like poverty, like mental health of people who will have been confined for long term. And so, because I think this can have very long-term consequences. So we have to measure them, take them into account now, and also then try to put in place like appropriate interventions for the future. And I think at the end, we should take a step back and think about what are the measures in those kinds of crises and how can data be used. So I'm gonna skip all the detail slide just to finish with like the last four slides. So as I mentioned, I really think that it cannot be just like a tech kind of, you know, researchy insight-based like solutions. I really do not believe in this because we've tried it many times and I think we've sort of failed many times. So this notion of trying to promote local awareness, information to fight, you know, fake news about the virus, to answer questions that people have. So there are different ways, like data and tech, of course, enable to do that. There are like chatbots, and we're trying to deploy in local languages. And so I think trying to connect with people to build trust, such that anything from the research can then be like presented, and then people will believe it. First of all, that it will reach them, but then they will also believe it is absolutely critical. I think there needs to be also like connections locally between different actors and between different countries. And it is a big challenge because there are so many initiatives going on. Everybody wants to do something. So there isn't very much coordination. So I think there's also a need to work on the coordination at the coordination level. Then now and later, issues of capacities have been mentioned. And so I do think that providing some like quick tips for respondents, for authorities on how to use data, what models are available. So it could be like short videos. It needs to be done now, but then in the longer term, there needs to be this like uptake increase in overall data literacy and capacities. And then last, I think we really have to, and this is like the last two slides, I think we really have to think a bit bolder and longer term. So I see, at least in the short term, I think the question of social protection policy like cash transfers, identifying which households are in most need, how to channel cash to those to those households. So there is work leveraging data to try and distinguish like false negative and false positive in conditional cash transfer. And then the last point really is that this is really for me an opportunity to not just like it's not just about responding and recovering. It's really about rewiring our societies and economies. And so once this is done, I think we need to take a step back and think about how we must like rethink our social systems, our values, our priorities, such that in the future we're better able to act upon information that may come about a pandemic, but more largely that we use this crisis as an opportunity to actually change some of the very structural challenges, I think, that will have compounded and will have been compounded by the crisis. So I have like those key messages. I will leave them here for now, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. I've got one question here for you so far. And again, I encourage everyone to ask their questions either in the chat box or directly in the Q&A box, and I'll share those with the speaker. So the first question, Mark Fiorina, and it's a question if you can give a general idea about how to build trust at a local level, particularly places where populations have trust in their government.
I mean, there's no. So I'm gonna turn off the video. Just I can do that. Yes. Okay, just to save bandwidth. I mean, there's no secret recipe, I think, for building trust. I think it's based on like trial and error. So you trust the people with whom you've had interactions, and they they didn't lie to you. They didn't. They didn't mess with you. So typically it's by working with people locally that are trusted. So to use those like trusted channels and trusted intermediaries to actually reach out to people who otherwise would probably not trust you. So there are some examples in Senegal, for example. There are like graffiti artists and other artists that are involved currently in the COVID like response, and they are trying to spread like messages about like hand washing. I mean, some very simple things, and they are those sort of like trusted parties. So I think that's probably the only way to do it.
Other questions from the audience, please do go ahead and ask. Meanwhile, I'm going to take advantage of my moderator position to ask a question. Marilee spoke a lot in her presentation about the challenges of, just the multitude of data tools and analytics that are pop up, particularly in the COVID response. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts to offer for government policymakers in particular, but also just for sort of interested audience members. How do you assess what are worthwhile tools, what are high quality tools, what are not, what is high quality analytics? What are the ways to think about, that sort of multitude and what should we trust?
It's a great question, Maria, and to help our World Bank teams, but also governments in general answer that question, the bank has actually developed a checklist for governments and for our task teams to use, a series of questions to go through, which ranges from, have you clearly defined the problem you want to solve? Are there any ethical concerns? How will the data be protected? Can you build onto an existing tool instead of starting from scratch? How does this, so there's a whole series, there are 10 key questions in the checklist, and kind of each of them are described in detail as to what a person should look out for when making these decisions. You know, ideally we want to have cost effectiveness evidence, and the bank is working on guidelines for doing economic evaluation in this space. There are some additional requirements like the value of information that we need to add economic benefit to in our cost effectiveness calculations. So we are working on normative guidance for those, but it's going to take a while for all these evidences to be out there. Plus, as I said, I think it's not just about individual interventions, but suites or groups of interventions. So that checklist might also be useful. If anybody online is interested in it, just get in touch with me through the organizer of today, and I will send you a copy of it. It's available on our website. Over.
Great. Thanks, Marlies. And if it's possible, if you could add the link that in the chat box here, that would be great. But otherwise, share it with our organizing team, and we will certainly put that up. Now, Emmanuel, one last question for you. This comes from Sarah Ratha in the audience. In terms of a different world post-COVID-19, what specifically do you think this entails? For example, in terms of working hours, communities, cities, travel. So maybe you can just give a few of your thoughts on that, and we'll have that be the last question.
Sorry, could you repeat the beginning of the question? Just the what it means in terms of?
How do you think the world will look different post-COVID-19, or should look different post-COVID-19?
Yes, I think should look different. Should look different. I mean, like, first of all, I think that providing like social protection, safety nets will be very important. I think we are going to see again discussions about some version of universal basic income. So that would be at the policy level. Hopefully, public health systems, education systems, other kinds of public systems should be much more based on the use of data for optimization, etc. But I think that more than anything, I think it's more about like values, priorities. I think that's what I expect to. That's what I hope to change the most. For example, we're all now getting used to doing conferences by video. So maybe we'll all travel a bit less and not like burn the oceans by traveling all around the world. So I think there will be macro changes and probably changes at the individual level.
Great, thank you so much, Emmanuel, and thank you to all of our speakers. Given again the interest in staying strictly on schedule, I'm going to close this panel now. I know there were a couple of questions that we did not get to, and I would really encourage people to post those right in the end. And to kind of continue the conversation with other attendees. And if panelists are available, they can also join in the chat. But I think we have a lot of really, you know, interesting and well-qualified people in the audience as well. So please do continue the conversation that way. We're going to take a couple of minutes break just to set up for our next panel and get the next speakers online, allow everyone to get a drink of water and such, and then come back. So we'll start promptly at 1:25 Eastern time. So just in 2 or 3 minutes. Thank you all very much.